service tonight, following the unprecedented and tragic events of this last week. And I would like to invite and welcome everybody who is watching online this evening. There are many people around the world who are joining in this service as well, so you are very welcome. Could I ask you firstly, please, to ensure that your mobile phones are switched off or turned to silent mode? And when you leave after the service, could I ask, please, that you do so quietly and respectfully? For those of the wider public who would like to light a candle in memory of those who've lost their lives, the church will remain open after this service, and you can go to the south aisle, which is on the right front chapel here, where you can spend a moment in quiet contemplation or prayer and light a candle there. There is a retiring collection at the end of this service on the way out for the Bailiffs Island Appeal, which will help those who have been most affected by the two tragedies that have taken place. We therefore hope that this vigil will offer some solace, a focal point for our collective grief, and an opportunity to stand in solidarity with those who mourn this night. And as we remain seated, we bow our heads in prayer. O God, tonight we gather here in shock and grief and confusion of heart. Help us to find peace in the turmoil, light in the darkness, and hope in our fears. And give us grace to face each day that lies ahead. Amen.
It is with a very heavy heart that I stand here this evening to address this gathering of the families and friends of those affected and those suffering so terribly in grief and heartache, and of course the people of Jersey. We come together this evening, embraced by the sanctuary of these ancient walls under God's roof, to pray together and seek some comfort from the disorientation and pain of what has been a brutal week, scarred by the dreadful impact of two shocking events that has affected so many islanders and left many with the terrible loss of a loved one. None of us would have thought we'd be sitting here this evening. Less than a week ago, we were all going about our normal routine, working and planning the lead up to Christmas, looking ahead with anticipation of families and friends reunited and the opportunity for putting the stresses and strains of our daily lives to one side for the festive period. But then last Thursday, the unthinkable happened, and we all woke to the news that a Jersey fishing vessel, the Clume 2, had been struck off our west coast and had sunk. Soon the dreadful news came through that three men, loved and respected men from our community, were missing. And whilst their friends and families in the wider island were coming to terms with that terrible loss, further tragedy struck at Hautemont in the early hours of Saturday morning. Jersey once again woke up the unimaginable news of yet another major tragedy, an explosion that has sadly inflicted the largest loss of life in a single incident in Jersey in living memory. And as we mourn for those souls already recovered at Pier Road and in the waters off St. Juan's Bay, we must remember too the ongoing efforts to find others who are still yet to be found. As we try to make sense of what has happened, we should give heartfelt thanks to the countless people who have responded so immediately and so magnificently to these unfolding tragedies. I know I speak on everyone's behalf to pay tribute and acknowledge the extraordinary actions of our emergency services as first responders and the subsequent search and rescue efforts, the state, police, fire and rescue service, ambulance, Ports Authority, Coast Guard, lifeboats, honorary policemen, and all the other emergency and response service who have acted with exacting professionalism, selflessness, and sensitivity in what has been challenging and harrowing circumstances. They are our community's stalwart sentinels, and it must be of some comfort for us all that when such dreadful incidents happen, they are always there for us. Those teams, supplemented by specialist services and enablers drawn from across the island and from further afield, are still at work this evening, continuing their recovery efforts at sea and ashore. Jersey has rallied across the community to help those affected by the rawness of loss, and those who are hurting, anxious and afraid. And let us not forget either the generosity of the wider community who has helped those displaced, providing shelter, warmth, food and a listening ear. And to Andium Homes and St. Helier Parish Hall and other members and organisations across the island touched by these tragedies for responding so swiftly to the need for emergency accommodation and providing other practical help. If there is any light in this darkness today, it is the sense of humbleness and pride in seeing our community, businesses and services responding with such dedication and compassion. On behalf of a grateful island, I thank all of them. To those of you who have had to bear the worst possible news, the families and friends of those who have died, I want to say to you now that we are here for you. We will stand by you in the difficult days and months ahead. Our support and our deepest sympathies this terrible time is absolute and heartfelt. On behalf of His Majesty the King and all Islanders, may I offer now our deepest condolences. But I'm mindful that simple words cannot begin to match the depth of your sorrow or quench the pounding sense of loss you are feeling. But I want you to know that you are not alone. And whatever degree of comfort that we can offer, we will provide to the best of our abilities. We all know that inevitably there will be difficult days and months ahead for you as you face your anguish and your losses. But I hope that you will take reassurance and solace from the outpouring of grief and support from across the entire island and beyond our shores over these last few days. And we hope that in your darkness and turmoil, you will have some measure of peace and comfort from each other and those who are here for you. Tears may be the silent language of grief, and life can change in the blink of an eye. But love is indeed eternal.
The Lord is my shepherd, therefore I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from Romans chapter 8. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors. Through him who loved us, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God.
It is difficult to find words that speak adequately into all that has happened in Jersey in this last week. Words which might comfort those who have had to listen to the most appalling news. Words which might ease the burden for those whose task it has been to search and recover. Words which might reassure those whose lives or homes have been turned upside down. Words indeed that will reassure all of us who feel a sense of grief and shock. And in many ways, my task is not made any easier by the fact that we are approaching Christmas, a time of heightened emotion and joyful expectation, when family and friends are at the forefront of our minds. And yet it is Christmas itself that holds the key for the words that I want to express this evening. Because as I've said many times, Christmas is all about presents. And I'm obviously not talking about gifts that we might give to one another, but rather the presence of people alongside us and with us. Both our readings spoke powerfully about presence. Psalm 23 said, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." 30 years ago, I spent some time walking in the Judean wilderness in Israel, and we hiked through a long canyon that cut its way through the desert called Wadi Kelt. In its upper reaches, it had steep sides, and the path wound its way precariously along the contours halfway up the canyon, with a steep drop on one side and a tall cliff on the other. The path was wide enough for only one person, and you needed a good head for heights as you walked along the trail. It was early morning and much of the canyon was in deep shadow. And as we walked along, we came across a shepherd ahead of us with his stick, and he was leading his flock of sheep through the canyon. We had nowhere to go. We simply had to follow them until the path became more shallow. And as he walked ahead of his sheep, he turned a corner on the path and went out of sight. The sheep between him and us began to stir and look a bit anxious. And as he disappeared, the shepherd took his stick, his staff, and he began to bang it against the steep rock face and to call out so that the sheep behind him, who could no longer see him, would know that he was there up ahead, walking the same path and leading them on. "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Your rod and your staff comfort me." It spoke volumes to me at the time and still does about how, when we face the most challenging of paths in our lives, when we can't see what is ahead, and we are anxious and fearful that we might be alone, that others are up ahead leading the way, that God is up ahead leading the way, not around the shadows, but through them. Presence. Those sentiments are echoed in that second reading where the Apostle Paul says, "I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the present or the future, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus." And it would be really easy to dismiss those words as mere platitudes that we might say to a group of people at a challenging time in their lives, such as that which we face today. But Paul was a man who had experienced terrible suffering. He had been imprisoned, maltreated, shipwrecked, flogged and beaten. But he was convinced that despite all those things, God was with him and nothing would separate him from that love. As our Lieutenant Governor said at the end of his address, love is indeed eternal. Presence. In all that has happened in this last week, it is presence that has made all the difference, as we have heard. the presence of people to bring comfort when many of you are now faced with absence. The presence of those who have searched diligently on sea and land to bring closure to the hurting. The continuing presence of those who will help to bring answers to the difficult questions that still lie ahead. And the presence of those attending here this evening to say to all of you who have been affected by these unimaginable events, we are here for you, we will be here for you. And to echo the Lieutenant Governor's words, you are not alone. Christmas is all about presence, the birth of a baby who is named Emmanuel, which means God with us. And this building, these ancient walls under God's roof, is a testimony to the firm belief that against all the odds, all the tragedy and darkness, when the unthinkable happens, when we believe that God is silent or absent or has betrayed us, when we walk through the deepest and darkest shadows, that actually he is there on the path ahead of us, just around the corner, with the gentle tap, tap, tap against the rock, saying, "Hear my voice. I am here."
Our Redeemer, you do not leave us in this life, nor abandon us in death. Hear our prayer for those in despair, when days are full of darkness, and the future seems empty of hope. Renew in them your sustaining strength, for we believe that there is nothing in all creation that can separate us from your love. In Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
God, our Father, we thank you that you have made each of us in your own image and given us gifts and talents with which to serve you and one another. We offer our thanks now for those whom we knew and loved and who have died in this last week in and around our island home, in those sad circumstances, for the years that we have shared with them, the good that we saw in them, the love that we received from them. Now, give us the strength and courage to leave them in your care and turn our grief into a firmer hope. Amen.
God of compassion and hope, when the unexpected happens or we feel lost or afraid, help us to remember that your peace is our comfort, your love is our strength, your presence is our joy. Give to us and to all people in times of anxiety, serenity, in times of hardship, courage. In times of uncertainty, patience. And at all times, a quiet trust in your wisdom and love. Amen.
God of love, draw near to us as we walk through these shadows today and in the week and months that lay ahead. Pierce our weary sorrow and gladden our hearts as you go with us on the journey, so that we may know your presence as our shepherd. Amen.
And we join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed
be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Ladies and gentlemen, we come now to the part of the service where we will commemorate those who have died or who are still missing in the two tragedies. I will read out the names of the lost, and after which I will invite those who have been asked to light a candle on behalf of the families to come forward and light one of the 12 candles that are here to represent those who are no longer with us. Could I please ask that you wait until I've read all 12 names, and then I will invite you forward. Once the 12 candles have been lit, other representatives from groups who have provided support for the bereaved and the displaced, or who have contributed to the search and recovery operations, or who have been on duty to help the wider public, will come forward and light some smaller candles, which will gather around the 12 that stand before us. So let us keep silence as we listen to the names of the lost. Michael Michielli. Larry Simeon. Jervis Ballygat. Peter Bowler. Raymond Brown. Romeo de Almeida. Louise de Almeida. Derek Ellis. Sylvia Ellis. Billy Marsden. Ken Ralph. Jane Ralph. May I now ask those who have been asked to light a candle on behalf of one of those families to come forward now and to light one of the candles in memory of those who have died or who are still missing. The organ will gently play as we keep silence. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, could I ask you please to stand? And we shall observe 2 minutes of silence in memory of those who have died or who are still missing as our final act together in this vigil service. Please remain standing for our final blessing. We commend into your hands, O God, those whom we love, but who we see no longer. In your great mercy, gather them to yourself in gentleness and love. Grant them a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.